Okay. Welcome back.
Let's do this.
So, I kind of don't have the lecture question for today. That's what I was looking for. So, that's fine because I had an idea for a lecture question that I'll just end up doing this one. So, and we're going to open with it. So, the Project 3 song ratings, I'll start with from the main website just so we can see. By the way, you can collapse the old sections. We're done with OOP and program execution. For the most part, I know you can still do the application objective of OOP, but you can collapse those and keep them collapsed. Song ratings is what we want to talk about exclusively for a while. And the idea of this project is that we're rating songs and then getting the ratings and analyzing them to figure out what the best songs are. With the repo that you download, we have some data from 2021, and we have song ratings, the YouTube ID, title, and artist and title, and then the rating for that song, how good do you think the song was, 1 through 5, and also the energy rating for the song, how energetic was the song. Darude Sandstorm's definitely a 5 energy. Even if you don't like the song and you rate it like a 2 or a 1, you can't deny that it's a high energy song. But something, The Lion King on Ice is going to be lower energy. Even if you like the song, the energy's low. I have way too many students who will just say, I like this song, 5, 5. And it'll be like a very slow moving love song or a slow dance song. They'll be like, energy 5. Like, I don't think you understood. So energy level is how energetic the song is. So sometimes you want a nice chill playlist. You're going to put all energy 1. And you know, give me good songs that are energy level 1 or 2. I want a high energy playlist. Give me songs that are energy level 5. And then a lot of the assignment is finding the right playlist based on all kinds of data. You know, give me a playlist. Give me a top 10 list, etc. So the data provided is from. Damn it, I missed something funny. So the data given in the repo is going to be for 2021. We have this site right here, UB Rating Songs, where you can rate songs. There's no, just a heads up, there's no authentication here, but you will put in your UBIT to be able to rate songs. Put in your UBIT, the thing before at buffalo.edu, not your person number. Please don't make that mistake. We see that so often. But your email address, and then rate songs. Get the YouTube ID, which is the 11-digit value for that song. Of course, I picked a song with a long intro. If you go to the URL, just play the damn song. If you go to the URL, you'll see the URL has this V equals and then an 11-digit string. That's your YouTube ID, and that uniquely identifies that song on YouTube. So grab that YouTube ID. Give it the accurate title and artist. Please don't just enter garbage in there. Rate your song to add it, or go through and rate other songs. Oh, I didn't put in my UBIT, so it won't let me. Invalid UBIT. And go rate songs that are there. So for the lecture question today, rate at least 1 song. Get your UBIT in this database somewhere. Your UBIT isn't shared with anyone else. It is private. It's only accessible on my server. But I'll go to the database, and anyone who rated a song by the time I check, like 5 p.m., we'll get the lecture question today. Because I lost the lecture question about recursion, I promise it was beautiful. Paul wrote it, and it was a wonderful question. But it'll probably end up being our lecture question on Wednesday. So your lecture question today, rate a song. As long as you rate at least 1 song, you don't have to enter a song on your own if you don't want to, but at least rate 1 of these songs with your UBIT. And then we'll get some data. I'll do this in the next lecture, too. Then we'll have some data to be able to get the best playlist of this semester students instead of looking at what 2021 students liked, which apparently they only liked meme songs. So The top 10 playlist from 2021 isn't that interesting, in my opinion. It's just a whole bunch of stupid jokes that, you know, if you like getting Rickrolled 20 times, that's fine. But it gets old after a while. And I got to plug in my thing.
In this song's done.
Yeah, last semester it was. I don't have a good way to get the playlist, but last semester it was like every meme song the class could think of.
Really?
Which, if that's what y'all like too, that's fine.
I just thought it was a word.
And then once you start working on the assignment, this main file in music/main, this will have code that will generate your top 10 playlists based on either Bayesian average or taking your ratings into account. And you can modify those, you can change those, get different results. When you have things working, you can download the current ratings. This will bring up your CSV. Copy this into your repo and then run your code on this semester's ratings and be able to see what the top 10 songs are for this semester. And we can actually write code that does stuff. And by the way, I love this feature. I don't want to shill or anything, but Opera, when you have YouTube playing like that or any video playing, it'll go in picture-in-picture mode. I don't know. I've been loving the hell out of that feature. But use this code. It's commented out because most of these methods don't exist in the handout code, and then your handout code wouldn't compile. I never liked that. So start commenting these in as you start getting your functionality written for your project. And I really liked it before. I used to have you do standard deviation as a method as well in task one. And then I do most controversial songs, the songs with the highest standard deviation in their ratings. I guess I got rid of that, didn't I? But most controversial songs is always a fun one. And then you can incorporate energy levels here too, which I didn't give an example of. What am I doing? All right, so let's talk about merge, sort, and recursion. And just a reminder, fill in one of those ratings for your lecture question. We'll get some good data to work with. All right, merge, sort, and recursion. Let's do this. So we're going to sort one more time with merge, sort. And just like I mentioned in previous lectures, I'm not, like, the goal of today's lecture isn't to understand how merge sort works. I mean, you should by the time this is over, at least at some level. The goal is to introduce you to recursion, to show you an application of recursion. Merge sort works by calling itself, which is recursion, which was supposed to be the answer to the lecture question today. Recursion, a recursive method or function, is a method or function that calls itself. That's what our recursion is. So I'm talking about merge sort, but I'm using that as a vehicle to talk about recursion, which is the topic I really want to talk about all this week. We're going to talk about recursion. Test two, it's all about recursion. It's two methods where, as long as I design this right, which I always find loopholes in my recursion questions, students will find them and say, I didn't need recursion. But if I design them right this semester, you should have to use recursion in the two methods in task two. You should have to. If you don't, let me know and I can fix it next semester, hopefully. But every time I'm like, this one requires recursion. I thought Bayesian average would require recursion for some reason because I was super naive. But Bayesian average does not require recursion. Nobody used recursion. And then I finally moved it to task one because nobody uses recursion for it. But the two I have there, I believe you do need to. Anyway, so we want to talk a little bit about runtime analysis. This course is not about efficiency, but there are a few cases where we can talk about it. This is, I think, the only one where we want our things to be faster. We use selection sort, but right from 115, we told you selection sort sucks. It's slow. It's specifically, it's an n squared algorithm, very slow sorting algorithm. We want to sort in n log n. N log n sorting is great. So we want to be faster. But what do I mean by that? Big O, I'll talk about it just briefly this semester. Big O notation isn't going to show up on your interviews. It's not going to show up on your quizzes. This is a 250 thing. CC 250 is going to talk about Big O notation and runtime analysis all semester. So you'll get your fill of it next semester. I just want to give you kind of a heads up. So with Big O notation, we want to count the number of steps an algorithm takes. And we usually count steps as basic operations. How many things need to be done to do this algorithm, for this algorithm to do its thing? And with asymptotics, we're going to ignore any constants in that measure. And we want to say, at which order of magnitude does the runtime grow as the input grows? So that's where we get our Big O notation from. Which you may not have heard of before. I shouldn't say it like you've heard of Big O notation before. So if the runtime of an algorithm, the number of steps that it takes, grows linearly with the size of the input, where for our purposes, the size of the input will be the number of elements in a data structure. If the number of elements of the data structure grows and then the runtime grows linearly with that, so we have some a times n, if n is the number of values in our data structure, some a n plus b, if that's our runtime, can fit for some constants a and b, then we say that's a linear runtime, and we say that's big O of n. We drop the constants, the plus b, the a times n. Those constants don't matter, and we're only concerned that it's a linear runtime, and we say it's O of n, or big O of n. If it grows at the square of the input, which our selection sort is going to do, we say that's O of n squared. There's some constant times n squared, some constant times n, plus some constant. It's a whole quadratic equation. We don't care about any of the constants, and we don't care about any of the lower order terms. We're just going to say it grows at a rate of n squared. That's a big O notation in a very short, brief nutshell. Is take the highest order, the growth rate of the highest order term, and that's the big O, the asymptotic runtime. If you want to think about that in calculus, if you keep taking the derivative of the runtime, it's the last term that lives, the last one that survives. That's your highest order term. That's going to be the runtime. That's the big O runtime before the derivatives. So if we analyze the runtime of selection sort, we're going to count the number of operations. And for that, we're typically looking at the loops. How many things have to happen? Well, when we look at this outer loop, this loops over the indices of the data structure. There are exactly n indices for a data structure with n elements. We have a list, so this is a list with n elements iterating over every single one of them. That loop runs O of n number of times. It happens to run exactly n times, but I don't care that the constant is 1. We don't care about constants in asymptotic runtime. We're just going to say that's an O of n loop. And inside that loop, we have a few things that have to work. These run in constant runtime, so these will be added. All these will be added to the runtime of this loop, which also runs O of n times. Now, this time, it's not exactly n times. It's going to be n minus 1 times, then n minus 2, then n minus 3, all the way down to 2, and then 1 times. But it's going to be O of n. We usually talk about worst case when doing runtime analysis. In the worst case, how many times does this run? And I'm kind of fudging this a little bit. We call it hand-waving the proof. I'm just kind of like, trust me, it's O of n. There's a more formal analysis. I'll actually briefly show it. But again, a lot of that stuff I'm going to save for 250. 250 is going to have you writing runtime analyses and proving that the runtime mathematically is actually n squared or n log n or whatever the runtime is. I'll save that for the 250 instructor. I got enough stuff to teach you. So the whole thing is going to be n, O of n, times O of n. So this loop runs O of n times, O of n times. So we multiply those and we get our O of n squared runtime for the algorithm. But my implementation of this is actually so bad that it's O of n cubed. So my implementation of the algorithm is terrible. This apply method, which is the same as saying data of j will call apply the apply method. I'm explicitly calling apply. It's the same thing. But this is going to take linear time. To get the jth element of a linked list like I'm doing here, we have to start at the beginning of the list and then hop all over memory j times. And j is going to be n minus I, where I... Right, well, not necessarily. Anyway, it's going to be something between i and n. It's going to be of order n, and it's going to be O of n. So it's going to get our n cubed runtime, since this is inside the inner loop. So n times, this runs n times, which runs this n times, which runs this O of n runtime algorithm. So we got a terrible application here. A terrible runtime. So, and that code's in the repo. If you want to run that, I have some code that runs these algorithms and then shows the runtime. If I have time at the end of this lecture, I don't think I will, but I could go in and run them. But if not, go into the repo, and you can time that out and see how slow that is on an input. You can generate a list of size 100 and 1,000. I have the code to do that, and then see how long it takes, and it'll measure the runtime. Since I hand-waved it so much, and I said that inner loop, it'll run n, actually not n, but n minus 1 all the way to 1. So most of the time, it's not like O of n runtime. Sometimes it only runs loops once or twice or three times. Those are constants, and we don't care about constants, you might be tempted to say. But if you add up that loop for every iteration, so on the first time, it's going to be n minus 1, then n minus 2, all the way down to 1. But if you sum all those up and use this identity, you're going to get an n squared, O of n squared runtime. The 1 half, that's a constant, we don't care. The n over 2, that's a lower order term, we don't care. It's O of n squared, even when we spell it out. So this is more of a little bit deeper into the mathematical proof of why this is n squared, without just saying, well, worst case, it's O of n, so it's O of n. No, it's actually O of n squared when you take both loops into consideration simultaneously. The inner loop runs n squared over 2 plus n over 2. Times, I guess, minus n, because I have the extra n term in there. So we do have our n squared runtime, and then, of course, an n cubed implementation. This will be important in, I don't know so much in 250, but in 331 at least, the algorithm is separate from the implementation. The algorithm is n squared, my implementation is n cubed, because my implementation sucks. All right, but we can do better. You knew since 115, you know what's coming. We have an O of n log n runtime sorting algorithm in merge sort. There are several of them, but merge sort's the one we like talking about is professors. And this is actually the best we can do with comparison sort. So if you're sorting based on a comparator that takes two values and compares them and tells you the relative order of those two, if that's the way we're sorting, which is comparison sort, which is the way we've been sorting, N log N is the best you can do. You can't do any better than that. It's mathematically proven. There are proofs out there that say you cannot do any better than that. So we're asymptotically the best. There are other algorithms that will knock down the constants in the lower order terms. But asymptotically, merge sort is the best we can do. So let's take a look at merge sort. So the algorithm is going to be this. This is basically the whole algorithm. If the input has just one element, just return it. If you give me a list with one element and tell me to sort it, I'm just going to throw it back at you and say, it's already sorted. It's one element. How could it be out of order? It's one element. Done. So that one's easy enough. If there's more than one element, now we're going to do some work. And this is what's called a divide and conquer algorithm. What we're going to do is take this larger list and cut it in half into two smaller lists. We're just going to cut the list in half into two halves and then call merge sort this algorithm, start back at the top, on each of those lists. So merge sort, the algorithm, calls itself, which is what makes it recursive. This is recursion when an algorithm in this case, because we're not talking about code yet, calls itself. So call itself. If that input list has still more than one element, cut it in half. If it still has more than one element, cut it in half. Keep cutting it in half until the list has one element. And then once it has one element, it's already sorted. Just return it. So we're just splitting this list until every list has only one element, returning them. And then when we get the return values, so we have both halves sorted, then we're going to merge the two sorted lists into a single list that's sorted. So the primary goal, at least most of the work that we'll do, which I don't have shown on screen, the merging is a little more involved that we'll talk about. The primary goal of merge sort is how to take two sorted lists and merge them into a single sorted list quickly. How do we do that fast? But this is the whole idea of the algorithm. This is it. So let's visualize this a bit. We have a list. Now, merge sort works with any size list. I chose a list of size 8 just because it's nice and symmetric on the slide. It all divides evenly. If the list doesn't divide evenly, if we have a list that's an odd number, the ties can be broken arbitrarily. The extra element can go on either the left or right side. So for this, I don't have that issue. This splits evenly all the way down. So we're going to get a list of size 8. 8's greater than 1. Split it in half. Two lists of size 4. Call merge sort again. We have two lists of size, or we have a list of size 4. Split it in half. We have lists of size 1. And now we're good. Lists of size 1 are sorted already. They can't be out of order. So we're done. We have 8 lists that are all sorted. The trick comes when we have to merge these back up. So every list with one element is already sorted. And we have to merge these two lists into a single sorted list. So we have to decide how to merge two sorted lists. And to do that, we're going to really leverage the fact that each list independently is sorted. So we have two lists, 51 and 1. Well, 1 comes before 51, so we're going to merge them by switching them. 100 comes after 19, so switch them. Merge these two lists, 1, 19, 51, 100. Merge these lists, 2, 3, 4, 8. Merge these two lists into our final sorted lists. That's the whole idea behind merge sort. Recursively call itself until we have lists of size 1, and then start merging lists together by leveraging the fact that they're already sorted. In code, this is what it looks like, and this is in the repo. In code, this is what it looked like. I haven't defined merge yet. That's what we'll have to take a few slides and talk about that for a decent amount of time. But this is the top level algorithm. If we have more than one element, or if we have one element and I do less than 2, just in case I end up getting the empty list, If somebody wants to call a merge sort on the empty list, I'm going to return their empty list back to them. So I want to make sure I handle that case. But if I have a list of size 1, just return it. It's sorted. It's already sorted. Else, we're going to find the midpoint. I'm going to split the list. I have this split at method, which will give me two lists that I can set into two variables. I forget that I use this shortcut, this shorthand. Should probably just divide that into two separate lines. But we can return both the returned lists of the split at method into two separate variables, declare two variables in one line by using this syntax. And then call merge sort. This is where the magic happens. We're writing merge sort right now. That's the method we're writing. That's the method we're talking about. We're still defining this method. Yet we're going to call it. We're going to call merge sort. Merge sort calls itself. Magic happens, and then lists get sorted. It's wild. It's wild when we have recursion going on. So we're going to call merge sort on the left and right sublists with the same comparator. We still have our comparator using that syntax, taking a first class function, that fun stuff that we talked about before break. And just this spits out sorted lists. The left is sorted, the right is sorted, magically. So we have two sorted lists, and then we're going to merge them together. So our goal now, if we believe in recursion, which hopefully by the end of the week you'll believe in recursion, then we're going to merge these lists with the assumption that they're already sorted. Our merge sort algorithm sorts lists. So we're going to say, okay, that worked, right? Left is sorted and right is sorted. Now we need to merge these two sorted lists together. And that's our next goal. How do we merge these two lists together? Yeah, so if you have a recursive method, I should just let Nicholas answer it. Yeah, so every recursive call is going to add a new frame on the stack. So, and we'll do memory diagrams, don't you worry. Every time a recursive method is called, it'll be another frame on the stack. So we'll have lots of frames on the stack. If we have like an input list of a million elements, we're going to have a lot of frames on the stack by the time we get to the base case. Yeah.
Your recursive line, you want that to be merge sort, right? Instead of merge?
Yes. Yeah, these should be merge sort. They're calling this algorithm itself. This should be merge, okay, which we haven't defined yet.
Okay.
Quick quiz. I'm always blown away by this one. But if we do have an input list of a million elements, how many recursive calls is it going to get to be able to get down to a list of size 1? How many times do we have to cut a million in half to get down to 1? How many? 1,000, you said? 13?
What was the question?
If we have a list of size a million, and each time we run this, we're cutting it in half and then making the recursive calls, how many times do we have to cut it in half before we get to our base case of 1, a list of length 1? So how many times do you have to divide a million by 2 before it becomes 1?
20 times?
It's only 20. 20 times. You get a million all the way down to 1. Okay, well, let's start with a billion. That'll take a lot longer. 30 times. For every time you add 3 zeros, every time you increase by a factor of 1,000, it's only taking 10 more times to divide by 2. So you got a trillion, 40 times. That's it.
It's the logarithmic part of this algorithm?
Yes.
Yeah.
It's exactly it. So it's the power of logarithmics and exponentiation. So there are two opposite sides of the same coin. If you have an exponential runtime algorithm, you're in trouble. That's way slow. It's the other side of that. If you have an input of size 30 and your runtime is 2 to the n, you got a runtime of a billion. That blows up fast. But on the other side, if it's logarithmic, so we have log n, where the log n comes from how many times we're going to have to go down this recursion. You get the other side of that, a billion, it's only going to take 30 times to get down to 1. Logarithms are way powerful. Yeah?
What's the val under mid? Under mid, it says val left.
Under mid, it says... Right, this... Wait, this one?
On top of the highlighter.
Yeah, that one. Yeah. So I kind of regret this. I forget I used this shorthand, but I'm returning two values. SplitAt returns two values, and I'm initializing two variables and capturing both of those values in those variables. So I should just do this in three lines to make it more clear. But I'm just using a little shorthand to be able to capture two values and two variables in one line. Instead of capturing this in, I think this returns a pair if I'm not mistaken, and then doing dot first, dot second, I believe is how that would work if I didn't use the shorthand. What's tail recursion? Tail recursion actually doesn't put the extra frames on the stack. It's when your recursive call is the last thing the algorithm does. I'll probably mention that throughout this week, but it's not something you're held accountable for. Unless Paul wants to put on the quiz, he snuck other things on there. So for the runtime of this, the first question I want to ask is kind of what we just said, what I was just talking about, is how many levels to the recursion do we have? So if this length of the list is our n, how many times do we have to go down this recursion to get down to our base case? So in this instance, we have 1, 2, 3 times. We have 3 levels or layers before we get down to our base case. So in general, for any input of size n, how long does it take to get down to our base case? Well, my observation is that each time we go another level down the recursion, we're splitting the size of the lists in half. So at layer I have lists of size n over 2 to the I. Because I split that list in half I times to get down to the ith level. So my question is, when is n over 2 to the I equal to 1? A little bit of math tells us I equals log n. So we have log n levels to this recursion. And then each level, we have to merge lists of total size n. So if we can merge in O of n time, we'll have that n log n runtime that we're looking for. So our goal becomes merging two sorted lists in linear time. If we can do that, we got merge sort. Any questions on this? I mean, this is more of a 250 thing, but I'd be happy to talk about it if someone wants to know. Okay. Otherwise, we can move on to merge. All right, so our goal is to merge two lists in linear time. And we need the fact that these two lists are sorted. If these two lists are not sorted, we can't do this. It can't be done because we're effectively solving sorting in linear time. We know that can't be done. Sorting, comparison sort can at most be done in n log n time. Provably can't be done any faster than that. So we have to take advantage of the fact that the two lists are sorted, or else we're just sorting. Our sorting algorithm as a coroutine ends up sorting. Like, why don't we just do that at the top level? So we need to take advantage of that. And the way we're going to do this is have a pointer, not a memory pointer, but just something that refers, well, not a reference either. What do I call these without saying pointer or reference? I'm just going to stick with my slides and say pointer. That points to the first element in each list and compares them. Whichever one comes first, breaking ties arbitrarily, according to our comparator, copy that one over to the output list and advance that pointer by 1. Keep doing that by comparing the two elements that the pointers point to. And then once you get to the end of one of the lists, copy all the values of the other list over. This is our idea behind merge. It's going to look something like this. So we have the task of merging these two lists. We're going to create pointers that are going to be indices, the indices that we're referring to. We have pointers to the first element and pull out our comparator and say which one of these comes first. Well, one comes first in this example. So copy one to the output and advance that pointer to the next element. And then compare these two. Which one comes first? Two. Which one of these comes first? Three. Which one of these comes first? Four. Which one of these comes first? Eight. Reach the end of the list, so just copy the rest. And we end up with the merged list that has all the elements, and it's fully sorted. And each time we added an element to this output list, we only did one comparison. We did one comparison. We advanced a pointer. We did a constant amount of work. We didn't do much work at all. Constant amount of work. We did that n times. So my hand wavy proof that glosses over all the details says that this is an O of n runtime algorithm. I promise you it actually is, but I'm not about to do proofs in 116. In the code, it looks like this. My pointers are going to be the indices. I'm going to start at index 0. I'm going to compare. The big green box. How can I miss it? I'm going to compare the elements at those indices, and whichever one comes first, that's the one I'm going to advance. That's the one I'm going to add to the output list. And for what it's worth, I'm going to break ties by choosing the element from the right list. So if this returns false, which is either the right element comes first or it's a tie, I'm just going to break ties by taking the right element for what it's worth. If that matters to anyone, copy that element to the sorted list and increment that pointer by one. Else, break ties to the right. And then once we get to the end of one of the two lists, copy everything from the other list over. I guess now is as good a time as any. Apparently, we don't teach while loops anymore. A while loop has the same syntax as a conditional. These might be useful. These will be useful at some point in your careers. Quite possibly, I don't remember if I used one in my solutions for this, but they'll be useful at some point in your career. But while loop has the same syntax as a conditional. It's like an if. It's while, Boolean expression, and then this loops until this expression is false. They're fairly simple. I think we're talking about bringing them back to 115. It's kind of awkward that we don't talk about while loops. But that's what they are if you haven't seen a while loop yet. There you go. I used three of them right here. While this is true, do this, is how they're read. This is also super slow. It's slow and terrible, but it's easier to read. Like, there's a good amount of code here, but I'm willing to bet if you take the time, sit down and read this, you can verify that it does what we did on the previous slide visually. It does the same thing, just in code. Appending is also super slow. This is very slow. It's the appending doesn't hurt the asymptotic runtime because apply already bumped us up to n squared. But we'd have to get rid of all of the appends and all of the applies to get this to be an actual linear runtime method. There's also another big problem with it. Told you can't use var, and then I'm showing lecture examples with vars all over them. I had three vars in that thing and updated the values constantly as I'm running. Okay, fair. Here's the version without variables. It does require recursion, and it's much less readable. So I don't like doing this in the lecture examples. Just like for selection sort, I didn't want to show you the no var example because, I don't know, it's just more than what I am trying to explain in that lecture. But for those of you who want it, here it is. The no var version does use recursion. I might talk about this in more depth later in this week. But as a first example in recursion, or second, I guess, technically, it's not suitable. There's a lot going on here. And I use a lot of extra list syntax. I guess not too much. The drop you might not have seen yet, this will return a list that's identical to the original list with that many elements removed from the front. So I'm removing the first element, and that's how I'm advancing the pointers. I'm also reversing lists a few times here to get everything as efficient as I possibly can. So I can always prepend instead of append. And this uses a trick that I will talk about at some point this week, probably Friday. I need a method that could merges two lists and takes a comparator. I need this signature of the method. But when I set up my recursion, that doesn't really fit what I want to do. I really want an extra parameter. In general, you're going to have situations like this where when you're trying to set up your recursion, you really want an extra parameter, or you want to change the return type. You want to change something with the signature. And it's just too much of a pain to write a method that takes the signature, the input parameters, and the output type that you have to write for either return a comparator, or we talk about it with first class functions. You need to return a comparator that compares two elements, but you need three inputs to do your comparison, things like that. Same thing with recursion. We want to change it. So it's common to write a second method that's kind of your helper method that takes the parameters you want. I want an accumulator variable in here. Takes the parameters you want and then defer to that method with the inputs that you want. So I'm initializing my accumulator to empty list, and then my accumulator gets all of the results as we go down this recursion. And I'm prepending to the accumulator whenever I make my recursive calls. So I don't want to dwell on this example. I might talk about it later in this week. But just for those of you who are like, why the hell are you using var? It's so that code's easier to read, because the no var version is more complex. Also more dense. There's fewer lines of code, so there's less to read. But every line of code there is more mentally taxing. It's harder to read, at least at this point, because you're not used to seeing recursion. All right, so what we really want to talk about is writing recursive methods. This is what you're asked to do in task two. You have to write recursive methods. So it's nice to understand how recursion works. We can see examples of recursion, but you have to write recursion. So here's my tips. Here's kind of my ingredients to writing a successful recursive method. And don't worry, I'll repeat these like 18 times this week. I want to get you all to the point where you can write recursive methods, not just be able to read them. So first, assume that your recursive calls are going to return the correct values. At this point, this is going to feel like magic. And by the way, recursion is one of those things that takes a long time to understand. I never fully understood recursion until several years after I was introduced to it. It takes a while to really just see what's happening and to have more intuition about recursive calls. At first, just assume that your recursive calls are going to return the correct values. Just assume. It's right. So we're going to assume merge sort returns the right values here. So what we did in the explanation going through this thing, we're going to still make that assumption even when you're writing the recursive methods, and then write all of your logic based on this assumption. So when we wrote merge sort, we're just going to say, let's assume that our recursive calls are correct. Let's just assume that we can just call this method itself, and it's just going to do exactly what it's supposed to do. And then build all your logic around that. Okay, if merge sort does work, my task is to write a merge method that's going to take two sorted lists and merge them into one sorted list. Just assume that your recursive calls return the correct values. Then write a base case. This is the most important part. Well, they're all the most important part, but this is the most important part, I guess. Write at least one base case that has a trivial input-output, a trivial output for a trivial input, just a very easy case to write. Your base case should be super simple. You shouldn't be overthinking base cases at all. A list of size 1 is already sorted, return it. That's a good base case. Very trivial input. If you give me a list of size 1, I can give you a sorted list with all those elements. I'm just going to return it. I'm done already. It's already sorted. nothing to do. That's my base case. That's a perfect base case. Base cases, if you have integers, usually like 0 or 1 is inputs. If you're asking me to sum up all the elements of a list and you give me a list of length 1, oh, that's basically the same thing we're doing here. Give me a list of length 1, I'm just going to return that value. That's a bad example. It's the same thing we're doing here. But anyway, base cases should be easy. If I'm writing a multiplication method, my base case is multiply by 0, I'm going to return 0. Easy. Trivial base case. Trivial input-output behavior. And then the last ingredient, the fourth ingredient, is only write recursive calls that get closer to the base case. So our base case is a list of length 1. If you give me a list of any length and I divide that length by 2, both of these lists are half the size of the input, plus or minus 1. I got closer to the base case every single time. So I'm going to get closer and closer to the base case. I'm going to get a trivial output. When I have my trivial output, when I hit my base case, the assumption's true. This returned the correct result when I hit my base case. So I do get that true. That assumption, it's absolutely true for my base case because it's trivially true. And then my logic kicks in. Okay, well, it was right for the base case. Let my logic kick in and merge those things. Now that returns the correct answer. And now my larger inputs to the recursive call, I can see that those are going to return the right answer. If I have two lists of length 1 and merge works, I returned a sorted list of length 2. Now I have two sorted lists of length 2. My assumption was correct. I'm going to merge those. Now I got two sorted lists of length 4. My assumption is correct because all my logic flows. I'm going to merge those into lists of length 8. Now my assumption is still correct, and it's going to be correct all the way out to infinity. We have huge lists. The assumption's correct because my base case is true, my logic is sound, and my recursive calls get closer to the base case. Well, we're out of time. The rest of it's mostly emphasizing those points. I think I did that in the example already. We already did the lecture question. If you didn't hear, rate at least one song on the song ratings thing. I'll see y'all Wednesday.